In this video, I'm going to show you how to create the VHS or camcorder glitch effect in Photoshop. Hi, welcome back to the Photoshop Training Channel. I'm Jesus Ramirez. In this video, I'm going to show you how to recreate the VHS VCR effect in Photoshop. This is going to be a non-destructive technique, which means that we can always come back and edit it if we need to, and it will also allow us to use this PSD file as a template so that we can apply this effect to any photo. In fact, I'll link to this PSD right below in the description so that you can download it and use it yourself. But I do recommend following the tutorial so that you can learn how to create this effect. Even if you have no desire of creating this specific effect for your projects, the steps that I'm going to use should help you understand better smart objects, adjustment layers, and filters, and you can apply those techniques to any one of your projects. Okay, let's get started. We're going to work with this document here that contains this portrait and this text layer. I'm not going to spend too much time with the text, but I am going to use text on this image. If you're interested in downloading this font, I'm going to paste the link to it right below in the description so you can download it. It's called VCR OSD Mono. So I already have that text here. I'm going to disable it for now and we'll focus on working with the effect. And actually, right before I disable it, I just want to ask you to do one thing. I want to see who can guess why I use this particular date on this text layer. So if you know, let me know in the comments. But anyway, we're going to work with this portrait. And the first thing that we're going to do is rename this layer original. Then I'm going to right click and convert it into a smart object. What I'm going to do now is apply a blur to this image, because no matter how you shot your photo, it will probably be too sharp to pass for a VHS footage. So with this layer selected, I'm going to go into filter, blur, Gaussian blur, and I'm just going to blur it just a bit. I'm just making sure that the image is not very sharp. So maybe about 1 pixel, maybe even more. We'll play it safe at 1.5. So you can see here how we are losing all the detail in the image. Then press OK. What I'm going to do now is collapse that adjustment so we have more real estate to work with in the layers panel. And I'm going to press Control J, Command J in the Mac to duplicate that smart object 4 times. So now I have 4 copies of that smart object. And also, in case you don't know, a smart object is sort of a container that can contain one or multiple layers, and you can apply filters, adjustments, and distortions non-destructively, which means that you can always come back and edit the adjustments and even edit the contents of the smart object. And in this case, we have 5 different layers, but they're all linked. If I double click on one of the smart object thumbnails, it opens up a new tab, and in that tab, I can replace the image. So I'm just going to open up my libraries panel and drag a photo in there. The photo really doesn't matter. I'll just use this one. I'll scale it up. And I'm going to press Control S, Command S on the Mac to save and go back into my VHS retro file. And notice how all the layers were updated with this new image. And Photoshop also applied the blur to this photo. But this is not the photo that we're going to use. But now you understand that all those smart objects are linked with each other. So I'm going to close the tab, press yes to save, and we get our original photo back. What I'm going to do now is rename these layers. So this one at the bottom will be original. This one here will be red. And I'm going to right click on the layer and select the red label so that it's easier to see. This next one will be green. I'll do the same. I'll select the green label. This next one will be blue. And you guessed it, I'm going to select the blue label for that one. And the one on top, I'll call distortion. And I'll use orange for that. I'm going to disable the distortion layer. And I'm going to work with the blue, green, and red layers first. I'm going to select the blue layer, then go into filter, distort, shear. Shear allows us to use this line to distort an image, as you can see in the preview here. You can click and drag these points out to delete them, or you can click on the line to create new points. You have 2 options. Wraparound, which means that when you make an extreme distortion, the pixels will wrap around to the other side. So what that means is that in this case, half of her face is going off frame, but it's coming in on the other side, on the left-hand side. If I click repeat edge pixels, that won't happen, all Photoshop is doing is repeating the pixels that are on the edge. That's why you get that line there in the center. In this case, I think I like to use wrap around edges better. And I don't need an extreme distortion. I just need a slight distortion, maybe something like this. Then I'll press OK. And I get that distortion there. You can see the difference between the original and the distorted layer. If I double click to the side of the layer to bring up the layer style window, in the advanced blending options, I have checkboxes, red, green, and blue. Currently, the red channel, the green channel, and the blue channel are enabled, but I can click on one of these checkboxes to disable that particular channel, and notice that once I do that, I get this effect that you see here. I could also disable the green channel and only leave the blue channel enabled. So that's why I call this layer blue, because this layer only has the blue channel enabled, and that helps us create this illusion of a distortion glitchy effect. I'm going to press OK. I'm going to collapse the adjustments so that we have more room to work with. Then I'm going to select the green layer and do the same thing. I'm going to go into Filter. And the first filter on top should be the last one that we use, which is the shear filter. If I select that, it'll bring it back up and I'll make a different adjustment. It will also be a subtle adjustment, but it has to be different. It can't be exactly the same one as before, and then press OK. Then I'm going to double click to the side of the layer and I'm going to disable the red channel and the blue channel and only leave the green channel enabled, which is why we named it green, and then press OK. For now, I'm not going to make any changes to the red layer, but you can if you want to. Then I'm going to enable that distortion layer. And what I'm going to do is apply the shear filter once again, but this time I'm going to make an extreme adjustment, like so, and press OK. Then I'm going to create a layer mask. And in this layer mask, I'm going to select the rectangular marquee tool, and I'm going to create a rectangle across the entire canvas, like so. And fill with black. Black is my background color, so I can press Control Backspace, that's Command Delete on the Mac, to fill with black. I'm gonna hold Alt Option on the Mac and click on the layer thumbnail so that we can see this layer mask. So I'm basically gonna do the same thing over and over again, and I'm going to create lines of different heights and sizes. I'm gonna pause the video so that you don't see me do this repetitive task over and over again, but this is exactly what I'm doing and I'll show you what it looks like at the end. So I'll be right back in just a second. Okay, and this is my layer mask. And just to remind you, with a layer mask, anything that's in black will be hidden and the white areas will show through. I'm gonna hold Alt Option on the Mac and click on the layer thumbnail again so that we can see the effect that I've created. At this point, I think that I might have gone too far with the distortion, so I can always edit that. So I'm going to double click on this shear label in the smart object to open up the filter. And I'm just going to reduce that distortion so that it's not too strong. And I think that looks much, much better. So again, just to reiterate, that's one of the advantages of working with smart objects. You can always come back and make changes if you need to. What I'm going to do now is create a levels adjustment layer. And I'm simply going to clip it to the layer below by clicking on this icon. So now this adjustment layer will only affect the layer below, which is the distortion layer. So I can click and drag in the center point and drag it to the right just to make it a little bit darker. So this layer is a little bit darker than the layer below. Also on this distortion layer, I'm going to add a little bit of noise. So I'm going to go into Filter, Noise, Add Noise, and just add a tiny bit of noise and press OK. Now I'm going to create some scan lines, and that's really easy to do. I'm going to click on the levels adjustment layer, and right above that, I'm going to create a pattern fill layer. And I'm going to click on this drop down here, click on the gear icon, and reset my pattern so that I have the default patterns. And the second one on the default list will be the one that I'm going to use. I'm going to change the scale to 150. Then press OK. I'm going to change the blending mode to multiply and change the opacity to 25. So that's before and after, and we have very realistic scan lines. If I double click on the zoom tool, you'll see the 100% view. So this is what this image is looking like so far. I'm going to right click and select fit on screen. I have the zoom tool selected. Then I'm going to create a selective color adjustment layer. And this selective color is only going to adjust the color, and I'm going to apply a color tone. So I'll call this layer color tone. And I'm going to change the blending mode to color so that I affect only the color and not the luminosity. Then I'm going to select the blacks and I'm going to add 10 of cyan and reduce the yellow to negative 10. Reducing yellow gives us blue because the opposite of yellow is blue. The opposite of magenta is green. The opposite of cyan is red. If you can't remember that, simply create a color balance adjustment layer and you can see that relationship here. Unfortunately, the selective color adjustment layer is not labeled as nicely as the color balance adjustment layer. And by the way, if you're interested in finding out more about how the selective color adjustment layer works, then check out my video on color toning. I use it exclusively in that video, and I go into more detail on how it works. So I recommend checking it out. I'll post the link right below in the description. But anyway, now I'm going to create a levels adjustment layer. In this adjustment layer will only control the luminosity. So I'm going to call this layer luminosity. And I'm going to click on this black point and drag to the right. So now no pixel on this image will be darker than this shade of gray. And I'm going to click and drag the white point to the left so that no pixel in this image will be brighter than this shade of gray. So again, we're trying to create that low quality VHS VCR retro effect. Finally, I'm going to add one layer and I'll call it noise. Then I can fill with whatever color. So I'm going to fill with black. Black is my foreground color. So Alt and backspace to fill with the foreground color. Then I'm going to go into filter, noise, add noise. I'm going to make sure that monochromatic is unchecked. And I'm just going to increase the noise all the way to 400% and press OK. Then I'm going to change the blending mode to soft light and the opacity to 30%. And you see the effect we have here. And it looks like I missed one step. I apologize for that. I'm going to go back and double click on this layer and disable the green and blue channel and only stay with the red channel to create that effect you see there. I'm going to press OK. And the image is looking much, much better. Now I'm going to select the noise layer. Then I'm going to hold shift and click on the red layer. That way it selects all the layers in between. Then press Ctrl G, Command G in the Mac. And I can call this VHS/VCR effect. And that controls all the effects. If you would like to apply this effect to another photo, simply double click on the layer thumbnail to open the smart object. Then simply place any photo over the original. In this case, we'll use this guy once again. I'll place them into position, press Ctrl S, Command S on the Mac to save, go back into my working document, and now I have that same effect on this photo. So this is a great way of creating templates in Photoshop. But that's not all. I'm going to go back and just delete this layer and continue working with the image that we have been using. If I enable the text layer, then you'll have the complete effect. Once again, you can download this font for free. I'll post the link right below in the description. In fact, you can download this PSD file so you can use it as a template. And I'm going to tweak it a little bit more and improve on it so that the version that you download will be a little bit better than this one. Let me know in the comments if you enjoy this technique and what you learned. And also, if you decide to create this effect, share your results on Instagram with the hashtag PTCVids. I would love to see what you come up with. If this is your first time at the Photoshop Training Channel, then don't forget to click on that subscribe and notification buttons. Thank you so much for watching. I will talk to you again in the next tutorial.